गुड मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रन, टुडे वील टॉक अबाउट द थ्री मेन काइंड्स ऑफ ब्लड वेसल्स एंड द मेजर ब्लड वेसल्स विच सप्लाई ब्लड टू डिफरेंट ऑर्गन्स ऑफ द बॉडी एंड द वंस विच कलेक्ट डीऑक्सीजनेटेड ब्लड फ्रॉम दोज ऑर्गन्स. टू बिगिन विद वील टॉक अबाउट थ्री मेन काइंड्स ऑफ ब्लड वेसल्स. सो एज यू कैन सी हियर आई हैव ड्रॉन देयर क्रॉस सेक्शन एज वेल. So the first kind of blood vessel is the artery. We have spoken about artery before also. Second is vein and third are the capillaries. Now what are the arteries? Arteries are the blood vessels which carry oxygenated blood. And whenever we say something carries something, some tube carries something, what else you need to add? What, from where, to where. So arteries carry what? Oxygenated blood. From where? Away from the heart. To where? Into the organ. So arteries carry oxygenated blood away from the heart towards the organ. So we've spoken about what it's carrying and the direction of flow. Veins carry deoxygenated blood away from organs and towards the heart. If you see this plan of circulation, which I'll be explaining later, but arteries are shown here in red, and you can see arteries are carrying blood away from the heart and into the organ, and it's been shown in red color. That means which kind of blood are we talking about? Oxygenated blood. But if you have noticed, we have spoken about this earlier also, that pulmonary vein is carrying oxygenated blood, but pulmonary artery is carrying deoxygenated blood. So now your complete point would be arteries carry oxygenated blood away from heart towards the organ except for pulmonary artery. And likewise for veins, veins carry deoxygenated blood away from organs towards the heart except for pulmonary vein. So this will be the first difference between artery and vein. There is a connection between artery, vein and capillary, which has been depicted here. Arteries first divide into finer branches, which are called arterioles. Arterioles further divide into capillaries. Capillaries unite to form venules, and venules finally unite to form the vein. So if you have to arrange it in a logical sequence, your sequence would be artery, arterioles, capillaries, venules and vein. And this would help us to write the second difference between artery and vein. An artery always breaks into capillaries. First it breaks into arterioles, which further divide into capillaries. So an artery always ends in capillaries, whereas a vein always arises from capillaries. So first point was what do they carry and the direction in which they carry. Second difference is what? Arteries always end into capillaries, whereas veins always arise from capillaries. We'll come to capillaries, but first we are comparing artery with vein. What other difference can you notice in this TS at a glance? This central space, which is called the lumen or the bore, can you see this is much wider here and much narrower here? So our third point of difference is arteries have a narrow lumen and veins have a much wider lumen. That is, it is across this lumen only or through this space that blood is moving. So this is the third difference. Spot another difference. This outermost layer is the layer of connective tissue, and this layer shown in the form of elastic fibers is made up of muscular tissue. Can you compare the muscular tissue layer of an artery with a vein? And if you see carefully, you will find the muscular tissue layer is much thinner as compared to the artery. That is, veins have less muscular walls as compared to the artery. So if we have to compare the structure, we may compare the walls. That is, arteries have more thick and muscular walls, veins have thin muscular walls. Muscular tissue is there but thin. arteries have a narrower lumen, veins have a wider lumen. One more structural difference is there. Veins have valves. In a longitudinal section of the vein, you will find structures like this, which are what? Valves. We have spoken about the presence of valves in the heart, and I told you valves allow unidirectional flow of blood here and prevent its backflow. Now, why would backflow occur here? Veins are carrying deoxygenated blood away from different organs towards the heart, which is usually against gravity. So when something is moving against gravity, it is likely to take a backflow, and to prevent that backflow, what do we have in veins at regular intervals? We have valves opening in the direction of the heart. That means when this valve will open, blood will move where? Towards the heart. So imagine these veins all having valves at regular intervals opening in the direction of the heart, and as I told you, a valve's purpose is to prevent the backflow of blood. Now here, this is a general function. You don't have to write from where to where. You just have to write veins are carrying deoxygenated blood away from organs towards the heart, and to prevent their backflow, they are provided with valves, because they are doing this usually against gravity, except for few veins which are coming from upper parts of the body, that is the head or the neck region, which are bringing blood along the gravity. Veins usually carry blood away from gravity. So the third structural difference is veins have valves and arteries do not have valves. In this context, I would like to tell you something. We have spoken about the connective tissue lymph, which flows through lymph vessels. So lymph vessels also often carry lymph against gravity. So there are chances that lymph would take a backflow, and so lymph vessels also have valves in them. So sometimes the question is there on the different blood vessels, but you are asked that which other vessel is found to have a structure similar to the one which is present in veins, and that is what? Lymph vessel. So two vessels in our body which have valves, one which is carrying blood is the vein, and the other one is carrying lymph, and that is lymph vessel. And purpose is to prevent the backflow of blood into the organs, and there to prevent the backflow of lymph. Now, differences between artery and vein usually are criteria based. You are given the criteria. So you may be asked that type of blood they carry, then you have to tell oxygenated, deoxygenated, and you have to give the exception also. Then you may be asked direction of flow of blood. So in direction, you have to tell away from heart towards the organ, or away from organ towards the heart. Then structural difference, in which three points will come: the lumen or the bore, the thickness of the walls, which one is more thick, which one is less thick, and the presence or absence of valves. Now, blood flows in the arteries with a jerk, because if you have noticed, the heart is pumping blood into the aorta. Aorta is the largest artery in our body, and that from that aorta, sub branches are coming out supplying blood to different organs. So, blood is regularly being pumped into the aorta, and every push corresponds to the ventricular systole. We have discussed that ventricles are the sending chambers and auricles are the receiving chambers. So with every ventricular systole, a gush of blood moves into the aorta under pressure, and that is why arteries need to have a thick and a muscular wall, because every time blood moves with a jerk, the wall of the artery, it enlarges, and then there is an elastic recoil, just like what you experience when you pull a rubber band and leave it. Same thing happens in the walls of the artery, and that regular expansion and elastic recoil of the wall of the artery is known as pulse. Pulse tells us the rate of the heartbeat. So arteries have thick muscular walls. Why? Because blood flows inside them in jerks, whereas in veins, the blood flow is very slow and even. Arteries are deep seated in our body. Deep seated. whereas veins are located close to the surface and we call them superficial. This is another difference regarding the location. So arteries deep seated and veins superficial. In arteries blood flows with jerks, whereas in veins blood flow is slow and even. And a question is asked on this only, that why when you are having a blood test, blood is taken out from a vein and not from an artery. So two main points are there. First of all, veins are superficial, so it's easy to take out blood from them. They are superficial, whereas arteries are deep seated. And secondly, the flow of blood in veins is slow and even, whereas that in arteries blood flows with a jerk. So if you are asked and give reasons why, you are going to write these two points. Now we'll talk about the three layers. Separately we are discussing the structure, but if you see in highlighted form in yellow, I have written the names of the different layers of artery and vein. They both have same layers, but it's just that thickness varies. The outermost layer made up of connective tissue, what you can see in the TS of the artery, is called tunica externa. It is called tunica externa. Tunic means covering and externa means external. The middle layer, which is made up of muscular tissue, is called tunica media. And innermost layer, which is made up of a single layer of squamous epithelium cells, we often call it endothelium, but its proper scientific name is tunica interna or tunica intima. A vein also has same layers, tunica externa, tunica media, the layer of the muscular tissue what you see here, and you have the endothelium or the tunica interna. But you can see the diameter of the lumen varies. It is narrower here and it is wider here. If we compare artery and vein with capillary, capillary does not have tunica externa or tunica media. It is extremely thin walled and is surrounded by only a single layer of squamous epithelium cells, which is known as endothelium. Endothelium, and they have a lumen here through which blood is flowing. Now, arteries are supplying oxygenated blood to an organ. Veins are collecting deoxygenated blood away from the organ and taking it to the heart. What are capillaries doing? We studied or discussed in the previous class that arteries break into capillaries, and these capillaries are very thin walled. Now we've studied that they are only surrounded by a single layer of epithelium cells. Why are capillaries thin walled? First, note down, for exchange of gases, that is oxygen and carbon dioxide, they need to be thin walled, because when blood enters into, this is an organ, what is happening inside an organ, the capillaries need to be thin walled to give oxygen to the needy cells inside this organ and to collect CO2 from it. They need to be thin walled for outward diffusion of nutrients and inward diffusion of waste. All body cells need to get rid of waste which has to come back into the blood flowing in the artery. So for diffusion of O2 and CO2, for diffusion of nutrients, for diffusion of waste. We also spoke about diapedesis occurring through the walls of the capillaries. What is diapedesis? WBC is squeezing out of the leaky walls of the capillaries. So the capillaries walls need to be thin so that WBCs can leak out of it or squeeze out of it. So function of capillaries, they are extremely thin walled to facilitate exchange of gases, nutrients, waste, and to permit diapedesis of the white blood cells. So I hope the structure, location, functions of all of these three blood vessels are clear to you. That is, arteries are superficial, veins are, arteries are deep seated, veins are superficial, and capillaries are present joining the arteries and the veins. Now when we say arteries are deep seated, there is an exception to it. There is a superficial artery also. Now if you press your two fingers on your wrist, you can actually feel your pulse, and pulse or the rate of heartbeat can be calculated only when we keep our fingers against an artery. So there is an artery which is superficial, present close to the surface of our wrist, and that is which artery? Radial. The radial artery is an example of a superficial artery. So that's an exception. Arteries are normally deep seated, but radial artery is present in the wrist, and we can calculate the rate of our heartbeat or pulse rate by pressing our fingers on this radial artery. Now we talk about the major blood vessels which supply blood to different organs. Now the complete plan of circulation is not in your syllabus. So I've just highlighted those body organs, the blood vessels which are entering and leaving, which is there in your syllabi. To begin with, we are already well acquainted with the pulmonary circulation between heart and lungs. I am repeating, the pulmonary artery carries which blood? Deoxygenated blood to the lungs. Why is this blood going to the lungs? To get oxygenated. And pulmonary vein is bringing back the oxygenated blood from the lungs into the heart. Remember, there are only two pulmonary arteries. From the heart, one pulmonary trunk originates, and that trunk bifurcates into two, and one pulmonary artery enters the respective lung, the right lung and the left lung. But from each lung, two pulmonary veins come out. So overall, how many pulmonary veins are there? Four. And how many pulmonary arteries? Just two. And what is happening inside the lung? The pulmonary artery is breaking into arterioles, into capillaries, which are uniting to form what? Pulmonary veins. Now they have brought back oxygenated blood into the heart. Now comes the long distance or the systemic circulation. We are not covering the upper parts of the body, but only those organs what I told you are there in your syllabus. Now the aorta comes down, and the descending part of the aorta is called what? The dorsal aorta. I told you we could compare the aorta to the fresh water supply which is coming in your locality. It's the major pipe, say, which is bringing the fresh water, and then there are 10 houses in that lane, and every house requires its fresh water supply. So from that several pipes are coming out. Something similar to that is happening in our body. From the dorsal aorta comes out hepatic artery. The word hepatic is pertaining to liver. The hepatic artery supplies oxygenated blood to the liver. Now I told you, when you get a fresh water supply, you need to remove the waste water as well. So who is removing the deoxygenated blood here? Hepatic vein. And where is it draining it? Into the inferior vena cava. So you could compare this to the sewage line and this to your fresh water supply. Okay, the oxygenated blood, the deoxygenated blood. So what is the role of hepatic artery? It supplies or it carries oxygenated blood, and from where to where? From the dorsal aorta, and supplies it where? To the liver. What does hepatic vein do? It collects deoxygenated blood from the liver and carries it where? To the inferior vena cava. Next we'll talk about stomach and intestine. The stomach and intestine are supplied blood, though there is a common celiac artery which is dividing into subdivisions, but details are not in your course. So the artery which supplies oxygenated blood mainly to the stomach is the gastric artery, which is originating from the common celiac artery, and to the intestines is mesenteric artery. So gastric and mesenteric arteries are supplying oxygenated blood to the stomach and intestine. But something different is happening here. No vessel is coming out from the stomach and intestine and opening into the inferior vena cava. Why is it so? Because when oxygenated blood is supplied to the gut, this is the gut area, what happens? In a gut area, what is happening? Digestion and absorption of food. Now the blood becomes laden with loads of nutrients, your glucose, amino acids, vitamins, lots of whatever you have eaten, it is digested and absorbed here. Body does not want all those nutrients to be dumped directly into the inferior vena cava. It needs to be balanced. The liver is doing that balancing work. You could say it is regulating the contents. Every time we are not eating balanced diet, our diet is often rich, more rich in carbohydrates or in fats. So it's not a balanced diet. Who is doing the internal balancing? Liver. It's just like a checkpost. When you pass through a checkpost, you have to pay a toll tax. So there is some tax which has to be paid here. And for that, the route goes via liver. It does not go directly into the inferior vena cava. So another blood vessel called hepatic portal vein originates from the gut and carries the blood first to the liver. Instead of having a gastric and mesenteric vein which is opening into the vena cava, what do we have? Hepatic portal vein. But something is very different about this portal vein. We studied arteries end in capillaries and veins arise from capillaries. I am repeating, arteries end in capillaries and veins arise from capillaries, but our portal vein is following none of these rules. It is arising from capillaries and also ending in capillaries. When the gastric and mesenteric arteries entered the gut, they broke into arterioles and then into capillaries. The capillaries united and formed the vein, which was very natural because capillaries unite to form the vein. But now when this vein entered into the liver, it again broke into a network of capillaries. Meanwhile, hepatic artery here had also broken into a network of capillaries. All the capillaries from the hepatic portal vein and hepatic artery reunite and now form what? Hepatic vein, which opens into the vena cava. So now what is different about a hepatic portal vein, or what is a portal vein? A portal vein is that which not only begins with capillaries like a normal vein, it also ends in capillaries. And an example of such a vein in our body is what? Hepatic portal vein. And this system is called the hepatic portal system. So if you are questioned on it, you have to draw this part of the plan of circulation. You can skip this, you can skip this. This much area has to be made, that how from the heart aorta comes out, dorsal aorta supplies blood to the liver through hepatic artery, to the gut through gastric and mesenteric arteries. Here hepatic vein comes out, but no gastric or mesenteric veins come out. Instead, what comes out? Hepatic portal vein. And this system, this system is called the hepatic portal system. Now, what is the significance of this system? I told you the liver regulates the contents. Whatever we have eaten, it's going to balance it further. The liver, point one, helps to convert excess glucose into glycogen. It saves that extra glucose. If there's a lot of glucose in your blood, it will save it, convert it into glycogen. That is first point. Second function is deamination. Deamination. You've studied last year about this in the digestive system. The liver helps to convert excess of amino acids into urea, and urea is a toxic nitrogenous waste which is sent to the kidneys for removal. So, second function, deamination. Third main function is detoxification. If there are any toxins which you have accidentally consumed, the liver is going to detoxify your blood. Even alcohol or any other toxins, the liver does that work as well. There are many other things, but three main points you will write under importance of hepatic portal system, that hepatic portal system ensures that the blood from the gut does not go directly into the vena cava, but passes it first to the liver so that its contents can be regulated in the three ways in which I have just stated. So, I hope hepatic portal system is clear to you. Now, we'll move on to the next organ which is there in your syllabus, and that is kidney. Kidney is supplied oxygenated blood by the renal artery. So, role of renal artery, it carries oxygenated blood from the dorsal aorta to the kidney. And likewise, the renal vein will collect the deoxygenated blood from the kidney and pour it into the inferior vena cava. This inferior vena cava is again going to carry everything, all the deoxygenated blood, back into the heart. So these are the major blood vessels which are there in your course, that is pulmonary artery, pulmonary vein, their functions, your aorta's function, hepatic artery, hepatic vein, hepatic portal vein, very important, gastric and mesenteric arteries, renal artery. There are many more arteries supplying blood to our reproductive organs, that is gonadal artery, to our lower limbs and to the head region, to the neck region, but they are not in your syllabus. So we'll only focus on what you have to be acquainted with this year. So I hope the differences between the three kinds of blood vessels and the major vessels supplying blood to different organs and collecting deoxygenated blood is clear to you.